Hi friends, and welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, welcome to my channel. My name is Wendy Bender, and I am with a ministry called Inspire Ministries. And I am so glad that you are here. What I love to do here on this channel is just share my heart with you. And part of that is revealing to you parts of my quiet time and kind of just unpacking for you what it is that God and I have been wrestling through together. And that is what my heart really is for a large part of this channel. And so today, what I'm going to share with you is something I believe was almost like revelation to me yesterday morning, and I just want to kind of share it with you. Do you ever find yourself in your quiet time going, God, show me something. God, reveal something to me. God, I am not really hearing from you today, and so I am looking at something in scripture that I can hold on to today. And that is exactly where I was yesterday morning. Typically, I know what it is that I'm going to study. I know what it is that God and I are going to kind of delve in together during any given point in my day and in my week. But on this particular day, I feel like I really came to him with nothing. And I just said, God, would you show something to me in your word? And this is kind of that unpacking of what he and I did together yesterday. So I'm going to be in the Bible today in Isaiah chapter 51. If you have your Bibles, I would love for you to go grab that. You can pause this video and come back. But I am going to be sharing out of Isaiah 51. Now, my primary translation of the Bible that I use is the New Living Translation. So that's the one I'm going to read out of today. Yours might look a little bit different. The wording might be a little bit different, but the message I am hoping for you will still be the same and still be very impactful. Again, I'm going to be in Isaiah 51, and I really want to kind of just set this up before landing on the verse that I believe was revelation to me when I saw this. Now, this is a call to trust the Lord, and Isaiah is communicating here for the Lord, and he is giving us clear instruction as to what to do. Now, part of what he is giving the instruction to do here is he is asking his people to remember. And it's kind of like a look back on their past, all that God has brought them through, all that he has delivered them from. And so he is calling them in this first part of Isaiah 51 to remember. Three times we find the prophet saying the words, listen to me. So he's speaking for the Lord, and the Lord says, listen to me, all who hope for deliverance. He says that in verse 1. And again, we see that happen in verse 4. He says, listen to me, my people, hear me, O Israel. And then he says it again in verse 7, listen to me, you who know right from wrong. And so this really is one of those places in scripture where you see this repeated pattern, and really you have no other excuse than to lean in and listen to him, right? And so we get to verse 4, and verse 4 and 5 is where I want to be today. And it says this, listen to me, my people, hear me, O Israel, for my law will be proclaimed and my justice will become a light to the nations. My mercy and justice are coming soon. My salvation is on the way. And I remember when I just read that yesterday morning, and I was so captivated by one particular line in the New Living Translation in verse 4. And again, it says this, for my law will be proclaimed and my justice will become a light to the nation. I was having a conversation with someone recently. Now, I feel like I have had this same conversation with many people in the last several months, particularly a couple people that I've had this conversation with in the last couple weeks, and then really particularly one that I had a conversation with a couple days ago. And I feel like it is this ongoing conversation and maybe this comment that I'm hearing from people, this one line that I hear people say all the time, and that is, I cannot stand to see what is happening in our world. Now, again, this conversation I feel like I have had multiple times over the course of the last several months. And sometimes people are talking about the pandemic. Sometimes people are talking about the economic crisis. Sometimes people are talking about an election year like we had last year and just kind of the devastation surrounding that. And some are merely talking about the disgusting patterns that they're seeing in the people in the world today. And I feel like, again, I've had this conversation numerous times with people. And one of the things that I'm always saying as I am agreeing with them is this: light exposes darkness. And so, of course, the closer that we become with Jesus, the uglier the world is. And that's just the truth. I feel like that would still be my common reaction to those conversations is, man, I am right there with you. If you're on Facebook and you see the hurling of insults and the negativity and you find that to be disgusting and unbearable, I'm with you. I remember during the election time especially, I was very tempted to completely get off of Facebook. Why? Because every single day that I came to Facebook, all I felt like I was seeing was negativity. Whether it be hate for the current president that we had, or hate for the president that was coming into office in January, or whether it be that you just didn't like government as a whole, or you didn't like the decisions that were being made, it was ugly. And not only was it just ugly, it was disheartening for me to see, because as a follower of Jesus, I would come to Facebook wanting to share my faith with other people, only to leave discouraged and disheartened and not feeling like I had enough strength to actually stand for truth. And so what I would be tempted to tell people in this season is, yes, when you get closer to Jesus, when you surrender your life to Him, when you get into the Word, and when you make the declaration that you are going to live in a more positive manner, the uglier the world gets. I remember years ago, I would study scripture, I would be in my word for a majority of my day, just looking to learn and grasp all I could. And I taught Bible studies and led big groups and had mentorships in small groups. And every time that I did this, any time that I spent a great deal of time in the word, I would always go out into the world, whether it be, you know, go pump gas, or whether it go to the grocery store or the mall, or picking up my kids from school, whatever that was, I would always be in a place where I was so disheartened by what I see and the more and what I saw. And the more that I got into the word, the uglier it became. And why is that? Why is that? Well, when I read this scripture, I got to tell you something that really leapt off the page to me. Again, let's go back to Isaiah 51 verse 4, because there's clarity given to us in the Word of God. And it says this: "Listen to me, my people, hear me, Israel, for my law will be proclaimed and my justice will become a light to the nations." It will become a light to the nations. And so I went back again to my comment to everyone that I've had that conversation with, and that is what? Light exposes darkness. And I feel like I'm in a different place now than I was 5 years ago, 10 years ago, maybe even 10 months ago. I feel like now when people say to me, you know, I can't stand the ugliness that is in the world, something within me celebrates. Something within me celebrates the fact that they can actually see the darkness. Why? Because light exposes darkness. The light that is shining within us from Jesus, from being in the Word of God, it exposes those dark places. So when you walk into a room and you bring light, automatically you begin to see all of the things around you that are dark. Now, I don't say this to say that we have any place within us for shame and condemnation. It does not mean that we bring the light into the room and we begin to just expose all of the things that we see, but there is an awareness of what we see. In fact, I wrote it here. I wrote it in a note in my Bible. Right before verse 4, I wrote this: "Wow, light exposes darkness. The darkness we see is evidence of our awareness and our attention attentiveness to the light. So what that means is, friends, it is good news when you see ugly. It is good news when you see the compromises that are happening within our world. It is good when you see the things that so desperately need the touch of God. Why? It is because it means that you are carrying light. It means that you have light within you, that you are in the Word, that you are with Jesus, that you are spending time with God, and that you are looking so desperately, you are seeking after looking more like Jesus. And so when you walk into a place, you know, I would tell my friend the other day, she works in a very trying environment and she works around a lot of troubling people. And so one of the temptations for us is to shrink back from that, right? Because we think, well, we don't want to expose ourselves to that darkness. We don't want to, harm our light by their darkness. But the truth couldn't be more the opposite, is that our light exposes darkness. And so for her, maybe, and for most of us even maybe, it's not walking into a place and having to say, okay, I bring light into this place. I'm exposing all the darkness. See, don't you know I'm following Jesus and I'm better than you are? That is not what it's about at all. It's about this natural light that we shine into every environment that we enter. And we don't even need to say a word. We don't need to proclaim the gospel. We just need to be light. We just need to reveal the inner light that is within us. And so that means that when we walk into a room, whether it be a room full of unbelievers or whether it be a room full of people who think that they're following Christ, but they actually aren't, because they haven't made their mind up yet whether or not they're following the world or they're following Jesus, and so they are living in this place of divided loyalty, it means that you and I can walk into that place. And before we even speak a word out of our mouths, we begin to be light. We begin to expose the dark places. And all of a sudden, that light is so attractive to the darkness. It is so attractive to other people. They begin to ask questions. What is it that's different about you? Why is it that you come in happy every day, even though the circumstances don't warrant happiness? Why is it that you have such joy? And you see, you begin to attract the places in darkness that people so desperately need. I just wrote about this the other day and I said this: at any time I talk with someone who's discouraged by what they see, something in me celebrates. Something in me revels at the revelation that they've just discovered, because our perception of darkness is evidence of the awareness of light. And the thing is that we have to maintain light at all times. And in order to do that, the only way that we're going to be able to do that is by getting into His Word, by getting into Scripture, by conversing with Jesus, by having that intimate relationship with Him. And so we can celebrate too our ongoing and increasing intolerance of the grievances that break His heart. We can look at all of the things that, all of the decisions, let's say, by leadership of our country that are actually going against the very moral fabric of our country. And we can look at those things and they can grieve our hearts like they grieve Jesus' heart, right? And so we can have reason to rejoice that He has given us enough inner light to clearly see the things that ought to bring us once again to our knees in intercession and repentance. So when we walk into a room and our light naturally exposes the dark places of that room, then all of a sudden we begin to see for ourselves the places that so desperately need a touch of God, so desperately need Jesus, right? And so then when we see that, that, when we see the darkness, when we see these bad choices that are being made by Christians, and when we see the darkness that they are being exposed to, and when we see the places that so desperately need to be changed by Jesus, then we have a good starting point for our prayer life. That means that once we expose those things, once the light within us reveals those things around us that so desperately need Jesus, we have a place to know how to begin to pray for those things. You know, I was telling somebody else the other day, you know, our war is not with flesh and blood. We are not warring against people and their decisions. We are warring against the principalities of darkness, that there is a real enemy that is after our hearts, after our lives, to seek us out and to kill and steal and destroy. And so when we begin to see that is really the darkness, it's not the people that is the darkness. It is the enemy that is creating those darknesses and those dark places within those people. And you are a daughter, you are a son of light. And so when we enter into those places of darkness and we begin to be aware of what it is that we're really truly fighting against, then we know the places that we can begin to pray. How will God use us in those dark places to be light, to expose the places where other people then need to gain repentance and so they can know Jesus for themselves? And so we can look at other scriptures where it talks about light. John 1:5 says, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it." The darkness can never extinguish it. That means that when we walk into a place and we carry light, no darkness that exists in that place can extinguish the light that is within us. It's why it is so important to be in the Word and to get with Jesus one-on-one so that we get filled up with His light, so that we don't depend on other people's light. We don't depend on our family to do it for us. We don't depend on our pastor to do that for us, that we are obtaining the light from Jesus for ourselves. 2 Corinthians 4:6 says, "For God, who said, 'Let there be light in darkness,' has made this light shine in our hearts so that we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ." Ephesians 5:13 says, "But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes a light." Don't you want to be so attractive that when you enter into a room, when you enter into that negative space, that someone who has been desperate and steeped in sin for their whole life will be so attracted to your light that all of a sudden they will receive the light for themselves? I mean, at the end of the day, isn't that the cry of our heart as a believer? And then the last one is John 3:19-20 that says, "God's light came into the world, but people loved the darkness more than the light, for their actions were evil. All who do evil hate the light and refuse to go near it for fear their sins will be exposed." And so that really emphasizes for me the importance of not issuing shame and guilt and condemnation in people. That is not what this is about. This is just being light. This is just entering into a space that was once filled with darkness and being light. So friends, I want you to think about this today. I want you to celebrate when you see darkness, because that means that God is really doing a work in your heart. Be encouraged, because when there is darkness, when you can see darkness, it simply means that there's light in the room. And by the room, I mean us, your physical body. When you can see darkness, it only means that light is inside, and it really so desperately wants to get out and be revealed to the darkness so that they too can meet Jesus for themselves. Friends, I hope this has been an encouragement to you today. I hope that you saw it the way that I saw it. Jesus, would you please speak to the hearts of every person that is listening today to this voice of mine, that they would be encouraged when they see the darkness, that really what that means is there is evidence of light in the room. Friends, I want you to be encouraged today, and I hope this word has done what it did for me. Thank you for being here with me today. I pray that you would have an awesome day with Jesus. If you like this video, give it a big thumbs up so that I can continue to kind of just bring these videos to you and show you what it is that I am learning in my quiet time. Thank you again for being with me, and have an amazing, amazing, sunshiny day. Bye, friends.